Hello my friends, welcome again to my video channel. Today we will finalize this project and I promise it to you, it will be the last video regarding this transceiver. What has been left? Yes, FM modulation, the whole modulation path, FM, SSB, some minor items, checking the receiver sensitivity, maybe some alignment is needed in the receive path. Remove some of the incandescent bulbs here. Some look a little bit weak here. Additional, some feet are missing and so on and so on. Some cosmetic works has to be done. But first, let's start with the FM modulation. When aligning FM deviation, it's a good idea to have a first look at the so-called Bessel function. Please don't run away, it's not so difficult as it sounds or as it looks in the moment. It's rather easy when we have understood this. This Bessel function shows us the relation between modulation index on the horizontal line and the vertical is the amplitude of the signal. We have here the carrier signal and then the first, second, third and so on sidebands. The modulation index is a deviation, the maximum deviation divided by the modulation frequency. Spitzenhub is German, it's maximum deviation or deviation divided by modulation frequency. For example, if you have a frequency of 1 kHz, audio frequency of 1 kHz set to 5 kHz deviation, so we have 5 kHz by 1 kHz and the modulation index is 5 and we are here. And we can see here which frequency, which sideband has which amplitude. When we have no audio input, microphone is dead, we are here. We only have the carrier and no sidebands. And when we increase here the amplitude, the modulation, the audio frequency, then the carrier decreases and the sidebands appear, 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on and so on. And the most interesting point is here, is this one, when the carrier goes to zero. That's the first Bessel null for the carrier. And it appears at a modulation index of 2.405. 2 is 3 and 2.405 is the modulation index for the first Bessel null for the carrier. A second null appears here and so on, second zero. 2.405 means we have, for example, a deviation of 2.405 kHz and a modulation frequency of 1 kHz. Then the carrier disappears, but we have a lot of sidebands here. We have here the first sideband with nearly maximum, the second sideband here, third, fourth, fifth, and so on. When we increase further here, the sidebands increase. This also shows us that the bandwidth of an FM signal is not limited, because even higher sidebands with higher frequencies are always appearing a little bit. So the FM signal is always a broadband signal. And another point is we have a negative amplitudes. These are theoretical values. A spectrum analyzer typically used cannot show negative amplitude. It only shows the power dBm, dB milliwatts or so. So this is mirrored up. All these negative here are mirrored up here like a rectifier. So these negative waves cannot be seen as a negative wave, not with this type of spectrum analyzers we usually have here. Okay, but we will focus us on this point here. This is a reference point, first Bessel null for the carrier to set the deviation. For the FM modulation, and I show you on the spectrum analyzer how it works. This is a setup for the demonstration here. Signal generator set to FM. Spectrum analyzer signal is 145 megahertz here on both. Frequency is not relevant. I've chosen here modulation frequency in the range of about 10 kilohertz here. And can vary now the FM deviation here with this pot here, and you see here in this indication here that the modulation increases, and you see when I increase the modulation here, sidebands up here, and when I increase it further here, you see here at one point the carrier disappears here, and this is a point of Bessel null here, Bessel zero here. It's very difficult to find it. It's very touchy here. Okay, that's it here. Now I have the point of Bessel null. You see the center frequency disappeared. We have here a modulation frequency of 10 kilohertz. And here we have on the upper scale here, it's a little bit difficult to see. It's 0 to 5. I have 40 kilohertz maximum deviation, so the deviation here is something with 24, it's 24 something here. So this is a first Bessel null, because we have a modulation frequency of 10 kilohertz and 40 kilohertz maximum deviation, so we have 24 divided by 10 here. This is a Bessel null at 2.4. And you can see when I further increase the modulation frequency, the deviation here, the carrier again comes out here from the zero position, and then the next sidebands here go down to zero here. Oops, it's difficult to find it. It's very touchy here. Oh, yes, that's it, or not. I have to pray for it, but it's okay. You see, it's very, very touchy here. This analog concept here is not the best for this purpose here. But you see, this is the second Bessel null here for the first sideband, and so on and so on. But we are focusing on the setting of the first Bessel null here, modulation index of 2.4 or 5 here. This will be done in the transceiver, and then we have an optimum FM deviation setting. Another important topic is that this transceiver has not a true FM modulator, it has a phase modulator. It is called here FM modulator, but that's not true. It makes phase modulation. I will explain it. Here are the crystals for the band settings, with or without any shift or so, repeater shift, oscillator, buffer amplifier, and then there's a FM modulator, which only causes to shift the phase. We can see here microphone, input amplifier. It's a Vox circuit here, not important. This is an audio amp. This here is a limiter for the maximum FM deviation or PM deviation, followed by a low pass filter, and this goes into the FM circuit here. This FM only shifts the phase, as I mentioned. Then we have buffer and doubler, 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 and so on. So totally the frequency of the crystals here is taken by 8, and the VFO is also mixed onto it, but that's another topic. We have here phase modulation. I show it to you in the schematic. Now to the phase modulator, we have here the audio frequency path here. Here we have the input from the microphone here. It comes from the audio frequency stages here. Tone call unit, for example, also it goes in. First amplifier here. Then we have here the limiter. The symmetry can be set with this pot here. And this is the amplitude here. And the harmonics, which are caused by the clipping, are filtered out here. This is another low pass filter. And here we have the settings for the wideband and narrowband FM. There are two outputs here, two pins, which can be chosen by a plug. And one of these pins here go here into this stage here. And here we have the capacitive diode here, which causes this diode here, this little diode here, which makes the phase modulation. The oscillator here is this part here, but there is no diode for FM. There's only one capacitive diode, which can be seen here for the root function here, for receiver incremental tuning, but that's another topic here. But here is phase modulation made. But the rules for FM and PM are similar. PM only has one difference. PM always has a modulation index of 1. That means the higher the modulation frequency is, the higher is the frequency deviation. That means if a frequency of 1 kHz makes a deviation of, let me say, 2 kHz, then a modulation frequency of 2 kHz makes a deviation of 4 kHz. That's intrinsic for a phase modulator. The higher the modulation frequency is, the higher is the deviation. That's obvious because a phase shift, when we shift the phase very slowly, by the same amount, we nearly have a frequency variation. And we, when we make the same phase shift faster, then we also have a bigger frequency shift or deviation. So a PM is also an angel modulation, but not a frequency modulation. It's a lot of theory. Could be a separate video regarding this topic, but today I only want to align this transceiver here. And I show you the setup. That's the first setup for aligning the FM deviation. Signal generator is set to 2079 Hz. We will see later why we have chosen exactly this frequency. It has to be something to do with the Bessel zero. Small scope, and this scope is connected to the output of the limiter, and the other channel is connected to the output behind the low-pass filter, where the undistorted signal is regained here. Looks like much better here. Okay. The scope here is connected with channel 1 to the output of the limiter. Here we can see the distorted signal, which we set for symmetry with this pot here. Here we have the output behind the low-pass filters, where the clean signal is coming out, limited. Here we have the jumper. It's difficult to see for the narrow band and wide band FM here. And here are two pots here for separate settings, for narrow and wide band FM settings. This will be the next task, to adjust these four pots here for best FM or PM modulation. Now to the setting of the limiter for the phase modulation here. The generator here is set to 2078-79 or so. It's okay output. Voltage, I increase it to 1.5 millivolts. Root mean square. You see there's some clipping here now. The input internal resistance is 200 ohms here, and I think it's 600 ohms in the transceiver here. I will increase it a little bit so you can see it better. It's the upper trace here. First, I look for the symmetry of the clipping here. Then increase the gain a little bit. Again, the symmetry. I think now we have symmetry here. Not perfect, but it doesn't matter here. It's not so okay. The lower trace is the output of the amplifier, of the audio amplifier, which goes to the modulator as described. Okay, this is at an input of 1.5 millivolt root mean square. Is sufficient for standard microphones without a preamp in it. Only a simple microphone, I will show it. I will connect two different mics I have here. The first microphone here is a standard from ICOM. It's from my other IC2R1, which I have. It's an original mic, which belongs to this transceiver here. And when I go to PTT here, then you can see one, two, three, test. You can see there's some clipping on the trace here when I speak loud into the microphone here. It's can be seen on the top and bottom here that it is clipping. I can reduce the gain a little bit with a lever here. But when I go back to the 12 o'clock position here, I think it's a good choice here. And now I take the other microphone. The other microphone is a no-name microphone. I don't know where it comes from here. But it also works, you see. It's also good for this purpose with reduced gain here. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, it works also very well. So I think the setting is good for FM modulation, PM modulation, and then we can continue setting the FM deviation. And now to the question why we have chosen exactly 2079 Hz and not any other frequency. I want to have a frequency deviation of 5 kHz, and when I work with the method with Bessel zero, Bessel zero appears at 2.405. So I need a frequency of 2079, because 2079 times 2.405 is exactly 5000. It's a deviation here, which is relevant for this purpose. So yeah, you can divide 5000, the deviation, by Bessel zero, 2.405, and then reach 2079. So the job is now to adjust with this frequency here, with this audio frequency, modulation frequency, and the limitation just is okay. The wanted deviation of 5 kHz, 5 kHz plus minus, of course. You see, we have just starting the limitation here, the clipping here, and there is a pot for the output of the modulation stage here. I can vary this voltage here. This voltage is generated behind the clipper, behind the low pass filters of the audio frequencies and the microphone amp here. So it is more or less a true sine wave again. And this amplitude here is constant. When you reach the clipping level here, you see, when I further increase the input here, the clipper is active, but the output voltage nearly does nothing, only in case of heavily reduced input voltage. So the output voltage drops, that's normal. But this clipper here, when it starts active here, creates a constant output. And now I will adjust this pot here, which goes to the phase modulator, for exactly 5 kHz or Bessel zero for the first frequency. Bessel zero can be measured with a spectrum analyzer, of course, or with a receiver. I will show you both methods in parallel. And now to the alignment of the FM deviation. I will do it in two ways. First with the spectrum analyzer here for Bessel null of the FM carrier. And then the second method is to listen to the carrier with a simple receiver here, FT290R, in mode SSB. I have no CW filter installed in it. A CW filter would be a little bit more helpful to focus on the carrier, but it's not necessary if you have a good ear and you can focus on one frequency. That's not so difficult. The transceiver is tuned on 145 MHz. And when I switch on here, you see, that's the carrier, and we hear the carrier. No modulation in the moment. Keep this frequency in mind. Focus only on the carrier, not on the sidebands. And then I increase the FM or PM modulation, more precise. This carrier goes down to zero, sidebands arise, and when this goes down to zero, this pitch, audio pitch, decreases and gets down to zero. One moment. Make it a little bit louder. Okay, this pitch, not the sidebands, please. This means we have 5 kHz deviation at 2.007 kHz, 2087 Hz. That's the first Bessel zero for FM deviation of 5 kHz at this frequency. And now we have a problem, because at higher frequencies we will get a higher FM deviation, because the phase modulation has a tendency to increase the deviation with higher audio frequencies, because the modulation index is constant. So we have to do something. That means when we increase the frequency, we have to reduce the amplitude. How can we do this? Well, it's rather simple. We will just check the output voltage of the audio frequency amplifier here behind the clipper, and reduce the voltage by a certain factor, and the factor is 2.5 by 2.087. It is a linear relation between frequency and deviation, so we can reduce the deviation at 2087 Hz by this factor, so that we came to the 5 kHz at 2.5 kHz modulation frequency. What's the task now? We have set the deviation 5 kHz at an audio frequency of 2087 Hz. We know when we increase the audio frequency to up to 2500 Hz, we will get a deviation of 5.99 kHz. It's a linear relation between this by this is this by this. Can easily be calculated. The factor is increase of 1.198, or if you multiply it, 0.835. That means we have to reduce the modulation amplitude of the output of the microphone amplifier and of the limiter by this factor here, 0.835, or divided by 1.198 here. So we measure the output where I've connected the scope for the earlier demonstration, measure the voltage, and then reduce the voltage by this factor here. We just aligned the pot here for this line here, but we have to realign the pot for this value here, so that we have a less deviation at this frequency, but then we come exactly to 5 kHz at this one here. That's our next task. So I will connect an audio frequency voltmeter to see how it can be done. What I'm doing here, I'm measuring the output voltage of the microphone amplifier here behind the limiter here. This output here, connected it to the millivolt meter here, 1 volt full scale at a frequency of 2087 Hz, as we had before. When I go to transmit, we see the output is roughly, scale is 1, we are on the scale here with 460 millivolts. I wrote note it down here, 460 millivolt. We have here 460 millivolt. This is for this condition here, the upper condition here. We are now here, and I want to come to this condition here, so I have to reduce this voltage by this factor here. Let me calculate it. I'm not a mathematical genius, and you need to use a calculator here. 460 divided 1.198. This is 384. We are still at this frequency, so I have to reduce it down to 384 millivolts. That's what I do now. Where is the small screwdriver here? Here is it. 384. I will reduce it. That's 384. And additionally, I've aligned the narrowband setting. There are two pots here inside for 2.5 kHz. It's half the voltage, 384, half is 192. It's close to 200 millivolts here. I will adjust it here. I swapped the jumper also. Okay. This setting should be 2.5 kHz deviation. And now I will check it, the result. Counter check it with a deviation meter. I have a small deviation meter, which should bring us to the same results as we have here. And to see whether this method is okay. A short look onto the modulation meter here. It's, I think, about 30 years old or so. It runs up to 1 GHz. The principle is there's internal swept oscillator between, I think, 20 to 40 MHz or so. With harmonics, harmonics are generated, and if one of the harmonics or the fundamental frequency meets the input frequency here, then the PLL locks and converts the HF, the radio signal, down into an intermediate frequency range of 500 kHz here, which we could can have here also in the output. The modulation can be measured AM or FM here. We have a switch, AM, FM. We can check the symmetry, plus, minus, and so on and so on. And the instrument starts automatically when there is a HF signal here. It locks, but sometimes it locks not on the fundamental frequency, it locks on the one of the harmonics. So we have a wrong indication here. Also, the indication is rather instable when it locks on an harmonic frequency. So it's good to restart the sampling. And we can do it here again with this knob here to restart it. Okay, I've set it to FM, 5 kHz. The jumper here in the ICOM is still in the 2.5 kHz position. Remember, please, we have reduced the amplitude a little bit with the voltmeter, so we will get a little bit less than 2.5 kHz deviation. The modulation frequency is still 2087 Hz. You can see it here. This is the frequency here. I go to transmit. the jumper's in, okay. Okay, you see there's a loudspeaker inside of it, make it a little bit less noisy. You see it didn't lock on the right frequency. So I make a restart again. That looks better. We have 5 kHz plus minus, or upper scale here is 0, 1 to 5. We have 2.2 kHz at 5 kHz maximum. That's okay. Remember, we reduced it a little bit. We can calculate it with a calculator here, whether it's in the right range here. It should be clear. 2.5 divided 1.198 equals 2.086. That means 2.1. Okay, we have 2.2. That's okay. A little bit of an error is always there. Now I change the jumper in the IC201 for 5 kHz deviation, and we have a look at it. Okay, we are now at 5 kHz deviation in the IC201, measured 4.2. It's nearly the same factor at 2087 kHz. That's good. And now we'll make a counter check. I will increase the modulation frequency up to 2500 Hz, as we have calculated. Then we should have now 5 kHz here, because we have reduced it. We have reduced the output from 460 to 384 millivolts and the amplifier. So this is a new setting for 5 kHz deviation. If not, we can realign it a little bit, but I'm quite sure it's okay. So my first step will be to increase the frequency up to 2500. One moment. Okay. Doesn't reach it really. Now we see here the problem. The audio frequency, the microphone amplifier is not linear. It's a low pass. So it is limited up to frequencies 2.4 kHz or so. So it makes no sense. I have to a little bit to readjust it and to bring it up to the higher level here. I do it. Small realignment here. That's it. And now we can see when I reduce the modulation frequency. We're now at 1.3 kHz and so on. Deviation drops. That's the principle of the phase modulation here. We have to live with it, but it's an advantage because the speech always sounds better, is more clearly understood when it has a higher pitch, higher tones in it. It's not necessary to have an absolute flat response. But there is one danger when you use it for digital modes. Such a transceiver here, I think we will have problems. So I will look to the lower frequencies in the range of some 100 Hz. I'm at 1251, 4 kHz. Then I go down to kHz. We only have 3 kHz deviation, 800 Hz. At 700 Hz. We only have 2 kHz deviation here. And for much lower frequencies, you see the modulation nearly disappears. That's intrinsic of phase modulation. This would be a typical frequency range for some digital modes, 400, 500, 600 Hz. But the deviation is absolutely too less. And of course, there's not only amplitude error, there's also phase error. For such a modulation, is not good for any digital mode, only for voice and nothing else. And that's the result here. When you switch on with 5 kHz setting here, jumper setting. Okay, that's obviously the wrong one here. 15, no, it's not stable here. Restart. Restart again. Okay, that's it. We have exactly 5 kHz, a little bit too much, but I leave it. It's not critical. we never have a modulation only with 2500 hertz and nothing else. But this is a maximum point. Q450, 2500, and with lower frequencies again the modulation here drops. Okay, that was the phase modulation here. You have seen it's a little bit complicated, not so easy. We have the optimum setting found, and now we have a short check with a tone call with the 1750 hertz. The first alignment of the tone generator is to adjust the frequency, because before I can adjust the deviation, I have to make sure that the frequency is okay. For this purpose, I connect the output, the audio output here from this demodulation meter here, to the input of this generator here. There's also frequency input. I can measure the frequency. And I had to install a small bridge to make a permanent tone, not a tone which switches it off automatically after some seconds. First I have to find the zero. Okay, that's the carrier without modulation here, and then I switch on the 1715. That's not what I'm expecting here. We have approximately next scale 15 kilohertz, a little bit more than six kilohertz deviation. Okay, it's a little bit difficult here to adjust it. I have a 5 kilohertz now full scale. We now reduce it a little bit. The pot has nearly no setting range here at the end of the pot here. I think I have to do something in the circuit here. Well, that's not so nice. I have to rework the audio generator also a little bit. The tone call generator here, which is not in the perfect performance. Okay, next topic is, of course, single sideband modulation here. Then to look at the tone generator here, which is not the perfect one. I made a short modification, or better said, two modifications here of the tone unit. The first problem I had during alignment, that this pot here for the deviation here, it's R7, 5 kilo ohm, was much too sensitive. The wiper was near to the ground, and when I moved it a little bit up, then the deviation was much more than 5 kilohertz. You have seen it. It was impossible to adjust it. The reason is the output here is too much. It's IC driven by 9 volt here. So the output here, which comes here from this square wave generator here, is nearly 9 volt peak. And here I don't need a 9 volt peak. I only need some 100 millivolts or so. This is the input from the microphone line here. So I replaced the series resistor here, which is 10 kilo ohm, by 100 kilo ohm here. And now I have the possibility to adjust it a little bit smoother and more precise. So this R7 can be adjusted much easier. The consequence was, here's a voltage divider, 10K, and another 10K here. I had to realign the FM deviation completely, because the sensitivity of this amplifier for the microphone line increased a little bit. I mean, this resistor is 10 kilo ohm. We have also 10 kilo ohm here to ground here. Then we have a division by 2 by 1. When it is 100 kilo ohm, the next one is 22K, but the level here rises by some percent, 10 or 20%. it was a new alignment necessary, but it was rather easy to do. I only used my FM deviation meter and that's it. Another problem here is the capacitor here, the C1 is 3.3 microfarad. This capacitor here determines how long the tone is sent or generated. It's a RC component here. These two resistors here charge this capacitor up, and when it's charged up, then the via this line here, the tone is interrupted. The capacitor was okay, 3.3, I measured it, but it was too short, so I've chosen 10 microfarad, and now it's okay. I have a longer beep, approximately 1 or 2 seconds. Can be adjusted here a little bit with these pots here. It's also not so good. The chosen value is 33 kilo ohm on the variation. We have 68 kilo ohm in series here. I would prefer another dimension here, for example, 100 kilo ohm here, maybe 10 kilo ohm here to avoid a short circuit or so. I didn't change it. It works now and I'm happy with it. I made a short modification, or better said, two modifications here of the tone unit. The first problem I had during alignment, that this pot here for the deviation here, it's R7, 5 kilo ohm, was much too sensitive. The wiper was near ground, near to the ground, and when I moved it a little bit up, then the deviation was much more than 5 kilohertz. You have seen it. It was impossible to adjust it. The reason is the output here is too much. It's IC driven by 9 volt here. So the output here, which comes here from this square wave generator here, is nearly 9 volt peak. And here I don't need a 9 volt peak. I only need some 100 millivolts or so. This is the input from the microphone line here. So I replace the series resistor here, which is 10 kilo ohm, by 100 kilo ohm here. And now I have the possibility to adjust it a little bit smoother and more precise. So this R7 is can be adjusted much easier. The consequence was, here's a voltage divider, 10K, and another 10K here. I had to realign the FM deviation completely, because the sensitivity of this amplifier for the microphone line increased a little bit. When this resistor is 10 kilo ohm, we have also 10 kilo ohm here to ground here. Then we have a division by 2 by 1. When it is 100 kilo ohm, the next one is 22K, but the level here rises by some percent, 10 or 20%. It was a new alignment necessary, but it was rather easy to do. I only used my FM deviation meter and that's it. Another problem here is the capacitor here, the C1 is 3.3 microfarad. This capacitor here determines how long the tone is sent or generated. It's a RC component here. These two resistors here charge this capacitor up, and when it's charged up, then the via this line here, the tone is interrupted. The capacitor was okay, 3.3, I measured it, but it was too short, so I've chosen 10 microfarad, and now it's okay. I have a longer beep, approximately 1 or 2 seconds. Can be adjusted here a little bit with these pots here. It's also not so good. The chosen value is 33 kilo ohm on the variation. We have 68 kilo ohm in series here. I would prefer another dimension here, for example, 100 kilo ohm here, maybe 10 kilo ohm here, to avoid a short circuit or so. I didn't change it. It works now and I'm happy with it. A small problem is the behavior of the tone unit when switching the tone on and off with this toggle switch here on the AF board and not with the transmit 9 volt line here. Let's assume we are transmitting and then using this toggle switch, closing it. Then of course the tone is generated for a specified time, depending upon this capacity and this resistor here, RC combination, then the tone disappears, let me say 1 or 2 or 3 seconds. When we then open this switch to avoid a second tone coil, then this capacitor here keeps charged a little bit, and this charge is sufficient to block the tone coil here. And then when we switch on a second time the tone generator here, we have here again voltage, but the charge here is high enough to block the generator here, and we have an output, and we don't understand it. It took some time for me to understand what happens. It's a problem of the residual charge here of this capacitor here. So I have added here 100 kilo ohms in parallel to discharge this capacitor here. This capacitor is now always discharged via this 100 kilo ohms here plus this 100 kilo ohms to ground, 200 kilo ohms, 0.2 mega ohm times 10 microfarads. The time constant is approximately 2 seconds or so. So this capacitor here is discharged within some seconds. The power dissipation or heat dissipation is absolutely zero. 9 volt at 100 kilo ohms makes nothing. I've added this 100 kilo ohms on the board here. Maybe you can see it here between the plus and the ground, and then small isolating tube over it. So I have now this resistor, and this effect is also gone. And now checking again the output of the SSB modes again with a two-tone signal, audio frequency two-tone signal, 800 Hz, 1200 Hz fed into the IC201. Here we measure the output, the spectrum. Attenuation is additional attenuation. We have here a 30 dB power attenuator. So the upper line, which has here 10 dB M, is totally in reality 40 dBm. That's 10 watt. And now I switch it on here. I hope it's okay. And now the output signal with a two-tone signal, input signal 800 Hz and 1200 Hz. Each of these peaks have approximately 4 or 5 watts, so totally 10 watt PEP, peak envelope power, in a two-tone signal. Again, the bad AMD distortion here. This is caused by the bad transistor. I will show you the data sheet of the transistor in the next sequence. The transistor, the final transistor in the IC201, is a 2N6081. And this transistor is specified for FM mobile applications, FM mobile in class C. It's a FM class C transistor. Class C. This transistor is not designed for linear operation in SSB modes. This is obviously the reason why we have such a bad AMD and such a bad output signal. Other transceivers in those days, so-called competitors, I know one which also uses such a transistor, FM class C transistor. I think in those days it was not possible to use linear transistors for 10 watt in those transceivers, because the transistors would have been much more expensive than the whole transceiver. So if I have chosen the cheaper solution, class C transistor. So if you ever use such a transceiver, please never use a PA behind it. Never, please. It's horrible. We have seen the spectrum. Go back in the scene here. It is horrible. Well, the alignment of the transmit path is done. I've also checked the CW output. There is a signal, of course. Now I will check the receiver part and then align some frequencies, some crystal frequencies with the counter and so on. But the next check is the receiver sensitivity. This is a setup for the measurement of the signal and noise ratio of the receive path of the IC201 here. We have here a true RMS voltmeter. This voltmeter works with a thermocoupler and compares the incoming signal with a DC signal, with a reference DC signal, based on the thermo effect. That means the signal which comes in here is converted to a DC signal, which is truly the RMS based on thermocoupling. That means noise, distortion and signal is measured correctly in a true RMS and not in a peak or any linear rectification like other millivolt meters. So such a voltmeter like this here is very good for noise measurement and for receiver measurement. The output of the audio frequency of the loudspeaker here is terminated here with 6.8 ohms. I think it's specified with 8 ohms or so, but it doesn't matter, of course, here. It is plugged in here. So it's the FM here is not active. That's it. The signal comes from the generator here in the background, which can be attenuated down to the microvolt range and fractions of microvolts. Okay, let's first start with FM. The measurement of the FM sensitivity is done with the quieting method. At 1 microvolt input, the quieting should be 30 dB or more. That means signal plus noise plus distortion related to noise at 1 microvolt input is 30 dB or more. I've set the generator to 145 at 1 microvolt. I receive it here, and you hear it's approximately noise free. When I switch off the signal here, then we have a very strong noise. I will measure this noise and then the noise with signal, and then I have the quieting. I've connected now the speaker to the voltmeter here. Go up a little bit more in the sensitivity range here, okay. This is a noise, I've set it to 0 dB. And now I switch on the signal here. Noise disappears. The difference should be 30 dBs. This is 10, 20, nearly 30 dB. I have 1 dB more, then I come to 29 dB. Okay. 30 dB is required, but 29 is reached. I think it's okay. Again, I check it. Yes, it's 0. And at a signal of minus 4 dB microvolt, it's 0.63 microvolts, minus 4 dB. It's 0.63. I go down to 0.63. Off again, no signal. Then I switch it on. I should have a quieting of minus 20 dB, 10, 20, a little bit more. I come to 24, 25 here. That's also okay. Again, when I switch it off here, I'm at 0 here. I switch the signal on here. So I switch it on here. 10 dB, 20 dB, and minus 5, minus 25, and specified is 20 dB. Okay, I think the FM sensitivity is okay. Now let's go to the single sideband. The SSB sensitivity is measured in a similar way. but it's not the quieting measured, it's the signal plus noise plus distortion is measured related to the noise. I've set it to upper sideband here, receiving a signal of 145 again. You can hear it tuned here for maximum. Attenuator, of course, also for maximum here. And then I measure the output signal. It's half a microvolt antenna signal, and the sensitivity should be 30 dB or more between signal plus noise related to noise only. That means this signal here and this signal here, the difference should be 30 dB. Okay, let's have a look at it, whether it's 30 dB. I'm connected the voltmeter here. I'm always choosing a relatively high output level here to avoid to come into the range where the noise of the audio amplifier is relevant. I have here the signal, and now I switch the signal off here. And this difference should be 30 dBs. Okay, let's have a look at it. Well, look at it, 10 dB, oh, that looks not so good, 20. Okay. I found a difference of 20 dB, not 30 dB, as it is specified. It's not so good, but okay, it's not specified how to measure it. This specification here does not describe whether there's any additional audio filter used or not. I'm using the internal SSB filter, which is rather broadbanded. I don't know whether they used in those days different filters or different methods. I'm not sure. Anyhow, I'm coming to 20 dB and at 0.5 microvolt. Yes, that's true. Okay. So what about a half a microvolt, and when I reduce the signal further down, it can also still be heard here. This is 0.1 microvolt, and it still can be heard. So I'm thinking it's a rather good result here for this old receiver. And now I'm a little bit curious about the sensitivity at 0.1 microvolt. Same setup, you hear the signal here. It's rather noisy. And now I connect it to the voltmeter here. Increase the level a little bit of the speaker output here. Again, zero. And then I switch off the signal here. Okay, minus six. So the 6.5, minus 6 dB. So the signal plus noise to signal at 1 microvolt is 6 dB. Okay, that's good for a CW signal, but not so good for voice, I think. But it's a rather good value for this old receiver here. Another topic is the measurement of the squash threshold. It is specified as minus 8 dB or less at FM, but it's not specified to which this 8 dB is related. I assume it's minus 8 dB microvolt. When I calculate it, I come to 0.398 microvolt, let's say 0.4 microvolt. I assume it's the point where the squelch opens when it's in the maximum sensitivity. So I have FM noise here, and then I use the squelch setting here. Yeah, what happened here? Then I use the FM squelch here to mute it. Now it is muted, and then it should open at 0.4 microvolt. I use the signal generator here, start with 0.2 microvolt here. At 0.2 microvolt it opens, 0.3. So I think the The specified 0.4 microvolt are reached. Before I will align the frequencies, the Grassl oscillators and the transceiver, I will eject the S meter. I had to realign it a little bit. The specification is 5 microvolt for S9. There are trim pots for the zero point here. No input signal. And this is input signal 5 microvolt here. You can see it here in mode FM. It's S9. You can clearly see it here. Then I go to upper sideband here. I go to lower sideband here. Into CW. You hear additionally the side tone. Okay. With no input signal here, I switch it off. No deflection here of the S meter. There is one general problem when aligning oscillators, that is the load of the frequency counter. Some frequency counters, especially for higher frequencies, have 50 ohms input. You cannot connect such a counter directly to the oscillator. In the worst case, the oscillator stops, or it could be the best case because you can measure nothing, so you can measure not an error. But sometimes the oscillator continues oscillating, but on another frequency. And when you disconnect the counter, then the frequency jumps to anywhere. So the best way is to use here a probe of one scope with 10 megohm input. Do not choose the oscillator directly. Use the first or second stage behind the oscillator. Buffer stages, many oscillators have buffer stages. Connect this point to the input of a scope here and the output of the scope. Especially old analog scopes here, like this one, have outputs. And this output here can be connected to a frequency counter you see here. And then you have the measurement here with nearly no load or no load which can be neglected. And you can measure the frequency. I do not show the whole procedure for all frequencies and all channels and so on. It's boring, not so interesting. Again, have a look into my alignment procedure. I have published on my website. You'll find the link below of this video. But there are trimmers on it for the different modes and different settings, whether RX or TX mode and so on and so on. I just check the frequencies here. There are two counters in this configuration here. There's one counter in the scope. It's internally. It's hard to read here on the video. The second is this counter here. This counter is a very, very high accurate counter here. It has a Hewlett Packard time base in it, and it's calibrated against a rubidium standard. So I'm quite happy with it, and it's very good, but it needs at least a burn-in time for, let me say, 24 hours or so, one day. Okay, I will do it step by step. I don't show it in detail. Again, it is boring. And it's not so informative for you. Only a small hint. I have some problems here measuring the frequency in transmit mode, for example in FM mode, or same as in CW. When I switch on to FM, the frequency should be 10.7000. I switch it on. I see everything, but not 10.7. The reason is the high frequency, the 145 MHz, is coupling into the circuit here a little bit and into the ground. It's all open here, but the scope here has luckily a switch. Bandwidth limited to 20 MHz, and now we have the correct frequency reading here. That's a nice feature here. And such features can help in such cases a lot. And now this project is ready. It was a lot of work, much more work than I have expected. First, I had to remove some modifications here. Maybe you remember this rubbish here, what's inside this relay here, this PCB board here, or experimental board here with the AF output, some transistors here for the ALC circuit. It was a PTT control for an external PA. Again, you should never use this transceiver with a PA. The spectrum is too bad, especially in SSB. ELC control, don't know whether it really worked, but it made trouble, no output. AF output with a transformer instead of the standard output here. Okay, I resoldered the main board, the wires. I explained it, it's a typical disease of this transceiver here. If you ever get a transceiver like this and you have to work on it, first disassemble it and resolder the wires. I installed a new PL connector for the antenna. The PTO drive was lubricated here, completely disassembled, removed the old grease. Power supply was adjusted. The new fuse holder was installed. The tone unit, the control of the tone unit was restored. Now it's again in FM, 1750 Hertz, and not in SSB, as it was. Maybe it was for tuning an external PA. The buffer amplifier was repaired with an MMIC ERA 3 type. The FM unit for receive was realigned and checked. PA was checked. The ALC was realigned due to the old mod, this was necessary. Modulation was aligned, FM with a bezel function, SSB with a spectrum analyzer. All frequencies were checked, aligned, and the S meter, the signal generator here, the fixed channels here. had a small problem here, or it still has. There are four frequencies installed with crystals. One crystal is for 145.750. That's a repeater frequency, but the crystal cannot be aligned to this frequency. It's 1 or 2 kilohertz below this frequency. It cannot be tuned up. I swapped this crystal into my other IC201 I have, same problem. So it seems to be a problem with the crystal. It has a load capacitance of 20 picofarad as specified in the manual of the IC201, but maybe there is a problem with parallel and serial resonance. As I understand, it's a Colpitz oscillator with serial resonance. Maybe it's a wrong crystal for it. The other three frequencies, crystal frequencies, are 145.315, 145.265 and 145.065. First, when I saw this, I scratched my head, what is this? But I think these are frequencies for linear transponders, the output frequencies of linear transponders, which are controlled via UHF or SHF, and the output is in the VHF. But I think it's not a good idea to use a crystal, because the VFO here is rather stable and can be used directly for linear transponder operation. Okay. And of course some optical issues. I replaced the feed here, installed some new feed here. Bulb discriminator here is now installed, a new one. You can see it, the discriminator now is lit here. And when we go to the calibrator, you see when we tune it here, the center indication moves here. It's very nice. Some screws are removed and renewed from the case here. I had to cut new threads in it, M4. The old screws were M3, but the threads were damaged here, so I had to cut new ones in it. Well, one modification is still present, and I think it's a good modification. We have here a switch position, 144 duplex, as you see. on the quite left side here. That means repeater operation on 144 with 600 kHz shift. The Chrysler is installed for it, but it makes no sense. We have no repeaters in 144. But it is modified, so it is the reverse operation of 145 duplex. So it means when we have here 145 duplex, then we have a normal repeater operation, transmitting at the lower frequency, listening on the higher frequency, as it should be. When we go to this position here, to the utmost left position here, then the frequencies are shifted. That means this transceiver here transmits on the output frequency of the repeater and listens on the input frequency. That's good when you want to listen to an old man who is transmitting via FM repeater, and you want to listen whether you could work him direct without repeater, so you can switch from here to here and then go back and then say, okay, I can hear you direct or not. That's a good modification, and I left it, I didn't change it. Okay, I checked the box, noise blanker and so on, box settings, all seems to be okay now. CW is also okay here, output. Yes, that's it. When I got this transceiver, you remember the first video, it was a messy, in very bad condition, no reception, no output, no power, no sensitivity, audio frequency, receiver was also dead, some non-documented modifications and other issues. So I had to decide to throw it into the trash can or take it for parts or to restore it. I decided to restore it. It was a lot of work, much more work than I've expected. I solved one problem and I got two or three new problems. You know the story when you start such a project here. It's a never-ending story, but now it came to an end. I didn't give up. I was sometimes in the position to decide to stop this project and to say, okay, sorry, I can't do it. But then I decided to continue this project. And I think it was a good decision. Such transceivers are today very, very rare in working condition. You will find such transceivers in a bad condition, of course. But working transceivers are very rare, and some guys are still looking for them. It's a truly analog transceiver. It's not a digital transceiver. The analog transceivers have the advantage. They have a low noise floor, no Sperry. Disadvantage is, of course, they cannot be controlled via a computer, and they are not prepared for digital modes because the phase modulation and the microphone amplifier and also the audio frequency amplifier for reception is not designed for digital modes due to phase and frequency errors. This is a true SSB FM transceiver for speech or CW. Okay, again, project is finished. I'm happy. I'm glad to have done it. It's a good feeling now not to have it thrown away. I think it was worth to do it in spite of the very long videos. You have seen it many, many hours, and these videos are only a small part of the work I have done here with this transceiver. So you can imagine the time I've consumed here was much more longer. Well, I say thanks for listening. Give me a thumbs up if you liked it. Again, I apologize for the very long project here, for the long videos, sometimes a little bit boring, yes, I know, but on the other hand, I didn't want to cut it. Why should I do it? If someone is interested in it, he can look at it. Well, I say goodbye now and hope to see you again for the next project.